So this is a joint project with Mattia Albertini, a PhD student working here at TUSI, and Peter Bax from Erasmus University of Rotterdam. So we in this paper we focus on the health and labor market consequences of a treatment that can be considered low value care. I will be more precise in a while, and we focus on the role of practice style. So as you know, mental health problems are a leading cause of disability and suicide all over the world. And there are consequences on productivity because people with mental illnesses are less likely to be employed and less productive. And the good side is that there is increasing awareness to this problem, and this has contributed to growing also mental health care costs. This is in theory a good news, more people are treated. But we also know that people are treated mostly through an increasing consumption of psychotropic drugs. And we also know that often, especially in mental health, treatment practice hardly follow guidelines. And there are also some concern regarding overdiagnosis and potentially overtreatment. And we know that in this, the kind of treatment and the right treatment choose by the kind of treatment is chosen by physicians, so the physician role is central to determine the right treatment for these people. And we know from the literature that there is substantial variation in the intensity of healthcare services that is often driven by differences in physician practice style. So here I'm citing this paper by Cutler and co-authors, where they show that at least 50% in the large variation across geographical variation is driven by differences in physician beliefs about the treatment. And maybe is less stressed the fact that primary care is the most frequent to utilize healthcare services, and it often determines the initial treatment. So primary care is extremely important. All this because we focus in this paper on a specific treatment for some mental health care problem, benzodiazepine, that is considered an example of low-value care treatment. So what are benzodiazepine? So are this kind of drugs like the Valium, Xanax, that are part of the symptomatic management of mental health disorders. These are pretty cheap drugs that provide short-term relief and are quite effective in the short term to provide relief for insomnia and other anxiety symptoms, but they are highly addictive with important side effects. And that's the reason why, for instance, the Choosing Wisely campaign often list these drugs, especially among the elderly, but not only among the so-called low-value care treatment. So these are not low-value care treatment in general. Sometimes are useful, but for instance, they should be used only specific cases and for a short period of time. And we also know that they are much less effective than cognitive behavioral theory to address, for instance, problem of anxiety. Still, it is among the most prescribed drug in primary care. For instance, in the US, we know that 12% of the population is reported to use this drug in the last year, and it increases sharply with age. So, the prevalence, for instance, in Switzerland, the prevalence in the 65 plus population is 20%. Okay. And we also know, maybe also not many know, that is one of the hidden ingredients in the opioid epidemics was often use combined with opioids. Okay, so this is more or less why we focus on benzodiazepine. And here I try to explain in a slide what we do here. So we try to evaluate the effect of GP practice style in prescribing benzodiazepine on long-term health and labor market outcomes. So and the analysis is going to be divided in two steps. In a first step, you use administrative data about for today 600,000 people. In general, we have more than 1 million. I will be more precise in a while. Patient enrolled in Dutch general practitioner practices, so what in the US are called PCP, primary care providers. And we, using this data, we estimate an arguably exogenous propensity to prescribe benzodiazepines. Then, in a dynamic difference in different frameworks with individual and time-fixed effect, we compare the health and the labor market outcomes of patients treated by doctors with different propensities to prescribe benzodiazepine after arguably exogenous mental health shock that is the death of a close relative. So in other words, we try to compare people that are otherwise, or we assume that are otherwise identical, that receive the same shock, and after this shock, their trajectories in health and labor market might diverge because they are treated differently by doctor with different propensity to prescribe these drugs. So the results after the shock, we know the patient enrolled in more lenient, and for more lenient, we mean that prescribe more benzodiazepine, GP practices are more likely to get a benzodiazepine prescription, and this only means that our propensity works, have a higher healthcare expenditure, and show also lower labor market trajectory, so lower income employment and higher uptake of disability and unemployment benefits. This is more or less the paper in a slide. If there are no questions or clarification needed on this part, I can eventually move on. So, regarding the related literature, so our paper try to contribute this to several strengths of the literature. For instance, the first one, so we are closely related to the literature looking at the variation of care and physician practice styles. So the first papers, like the one on Skinner, look mainly, or the more recent by Finkelsteins and actually Finkelstein Quadros have also a more recent paper published on ER. But the idea here is to exploit variation, geographical variation, to figure out whether this is due to patient characteristics or supply side characteristics. More recently, there are also this we are more closely related to this paper related to quasi-random assignment. For instance, in ambulance referrals or to doctor in emergency department. Maybe the paper that is closest to us is this paper by Eckmeier and Zhang, looking at veterans that are assigned quasi-randomly to emergency department, and they look at opioids prescription. And then there is, in general, this literature on doctor adherence to guidelines that seems to suggest that adherence to guidelines is actually good and often improve outcome for the patients. Then there is a large literature on mental health that look at the effect, for instance, of drugs. We know from recent paper by Janet Carey and her co-author Emily Cuddy that, for instance, there is a large use of antidepressants for adolescents and children. Often they are prescribed inappropriately. Also, another paper in the Dutch setting, like our paper by also Janet Carey at Spheres on the prescription of antidepressant for postpartum depression. Also, in this paper, they seem to say that these drugs are not prescribed appropriately. All this literature, however, none of this paper look at the effect on labor market outcome. On labor market outcome, we have only some paper on the impact, for instance, of antidepressant or of lithium therapy, like in the case of the paper by Barbara Biasi and co-authors. But in this paper, they are not looking at the effect of doctors, but just at the introduction of the drug. No? For instance, whether you put a label on these drugs, whether you introduce, like for the Barbara Biasi's paper, the introduction of lithium after the 60s, and what was its impact on the labor market of the potentially affected people. This is more or less in the health, in the economic literature, and then of course there is a large health literature on benzodiazepine that, of course, is only in controlled settings or only observational studies. So we know that they are associated with increasing falls, emergency visit, potentially dementia, but of course causality is difficult to assess in these studies. And we also know observationally that in the U.S. there is an increased overdose mortality for people that took benzodiazepine, but of course, even in this case, the real cause of death is difficult to figure out. We only know that they die for drug abuse, and there was benzodiazepine. So this is more or less the literature. As I said, I think our focus on primary care providers, and maybe probably we are the first to show evidence of labor market outcome, should provide a substantial contribution to this ongoing literature. So, what is the background of the Dutch healthcare system? Maybe Hans, you don't need an update on this for more for the other. So it's important to stress that the Dutch healthcare system is based on the gatekeeper role of the general practitioner, and the GP care is free for patient. And it's important to stress also when we talk about our data that GP in the Netherlands, they work in practices of two or even more doctors. GP practices can be freely chosen, but in theory, but in practice, we know also by looking at the paper by Janet and Sphere that practice must be within the 15-minute driving distance in order to be reachable for emergency calls. And the other constraint is that practice must be accepting patients. And often many practices are full. So at the end of the day, if you are in the countryside, you only probably have one practice in your 15 minutes driving distance. If you are in the city, you have a larger number of practice to eventually select, but you cannot be sure to be accepted by the practice. So in other words, this leave very limited space for doctor shopping. And these are crucial for our research design. Then regarding mental health care, the starting point of any mental health care treatment in the Netherlands is again the GP, who can in severe cases refer to a specialist, a psychiatrist or a psychotherapist. But we also know that there are waiting lists, that for anxiety, waiting times are around 12, between 12 and 15 weeks in the period 2019 to 2021. And it's important to stress that policymakers, healthcare authorities are fully aware of the problem of benzodiazepines. And in 2009, benzodiazepines are no longer reimbursed in the Netherlands. Why? Because Dutch people used to have one of the highest consumption of benzodiazepine, around 10% before of the reform. And so they decided to not reimburse this drug anymore, excluding specific case. So in other words, from only 10-15% of cases can be now reimbursed. Despite this reform, doctors keep prescribing these drugs because they are super cheap. And we know from other papers that the consumption decreased by only 10-15% in general after this reform. Our data start from 2009, so we cannot evaluate the effect of this reform. All clear? So our data. So we have data from a subset of the Dutch general practitioners' practices. So it's a subsample of around 500 Dutch practices that are roughly 10% of the total practices present in the Netherlands that cover 1.2 million patients over the period 2009-2019. For this practice, we have prescription and diagnosis. These are linked via social security number to the administrative dataset of the Netherlands, the so-called CBS, that include labor market outcome, health insurance, expenditure, demographic data, address data. It's important to stress for today's presentation and that result of today will be based on a selected 50% of the sample. Why? Because obtaining this data, it's quite complicated. So to obtain administrative data from the CBS, it's easy. This important thing is that you pay, but and you, of course, your project is accepted. But GP data are a blind spot of the admin data of the Netherlands. So you don't have information in this data set, in this huge administrative data set on GP and on doctors in general. We were able to obtain this data through this association called Nivel. And at the beginning, they wanted to provide us only a subset of the data, only data for people that ever had any kind of experience with mental health care related issue, meaning one diagnosis of psychological or social problem, any prescription in their life of antidepressant, anti-anxiety, opioids. And I mean, I think this is more or less the subset of this is the criteria that lead them to this first selection that actually is 50% of the sample. So at the end of the day, At least one out of two people in the Netherlands had or one diagnosis ever in their life, or one of these three or four drugs I mentioned before. So the results today are based on this 50%. But we were able to obtain a few weeks ago the entire data set. So we have all patients. And we just ran 2, 3 days ago the results that are pretty similar to what they're going to show today. But for people working with this kind of data, we could not extract the figures on time for this presentation, just for full disclosure. So the results are based on a 50%. The new result based on the full sample are very similar, but we could not extract them because it's a long procedure to extract the data. Also because one entire regression might take a couple of days. So that's about the data.
There is a question by Stephenson Strobel. Is there evidence on quality of physicians selecting towards geographic areas in Netherlands? And do poor quality physicians select towards lower socioeconomic status areas?
What we do, this is an important point. All our leniency measures are conditional on area fixed effect, a very neighborhood fixed effect. So whether there is sorting, I don't know. I will show you that it doesn't change a lot. You will see later unconditional measure of leniency versus conditional measure of leniency that condition on neighborhood fixed effect. There are no big differences, but there are some differences. I hope it's clear, no? I will show you in a minute. And from GP data, we can also identify prescription that might be potentially inappropriate. So what we call red flags prescription. We can identify five potentially inappropriate prescription according to Dutch guidelines that are honestly pretty broad. So we consider a red flag, an appropriate treatment, a period of treatment that is more than 3 months, because 3 months is the maximum amount, period of for a prescription of benzodiazepine in the Dutch guidelines, a prescription without a mental health diagnosis, a prescription without therapy after the first diagnosis, treatment with a benzodiazepine only for light anxiety, and the joint prescription of benzodiazepine with opioids. It is possible that in some of these cases, these prescriptions are appropriate. The doctor probably knows better, but usually these are not according to guidelines, and so we identify them as potentially inappropriate. And probably they are really a small subset of all the potentially inappropriate prescriptions we might have in the data, because these are the ones we can identify in the data set. There might be other situations in which our data do not allow to identify them. So just to give you an idea of the red flag prescription and the total prescription in the Netherlands, so we know that the share of patients with a benzodiazepine prescription in our data is about 8%, and this is based on the full sample, not the selected sample. And we know that there is a high share of potentially inappropriate prescription. About 22% of the prescription are potentially inappropriate. I would like to stress that roughly 10% of these prescriptions are for more than 3 months, so chronic users that are really the bad ones because they might lead to addiction. Now, if data are clear, I would like to move on maybe on the most important part, the research design we have in mind. So what is the ideal experiment we want to mimic in some way? So we want to compare the outcome of otherwise identical individuals that are treated, for instance, for anxiety or insomnia by doctor with different practice styles. This is the ideal experiment. In practice, when you in usual in observational data, you have at least three, so you have mainly these three problems. For first, selection of worst in terms of health characteristics into high prescribing practice. You might have different trajectories already before the treatment. So, in other words, people that maybe are enrolled in more lenient practice tend to have different trajectory already before of these prescriptions. And then you might have pre-treatment effect due to previous interaction between doctor and patients. So how we think we address this issue? So first of all, the Dutch context mitigates the selection concern, as already stressed by Kerry and Sears in their recent paper on the JHR. And then we also condition on, I will show you that conditioning on area fixed effect, all the differences across in the pool of patients of these practices disappears. Second, we focus on patients with a common, arguably exogenous mental health trigger, so the death of a close relative. So we take patients that are healthy and that have no benzo anxiety, insomnia, depression before the shock for up to 3 years. These are a sort of a washout period. And so we focus on this patient and that are triggered by this quite a tough mental health trigger that is the death of a close relative, so a child, a partner, a parent, or some sibling during the period 2010-2009. So in other words, we have people that have no mental health issue in the 3 years before. Then they are hit by this mental health shock that is the death of a close relative, and we observe whether their trajectories diverge or not after this shock because treated by different doctors. This is more or less the idea. Of course, I'm gonna discuss the identification assumption more into detail later, but I want to give you the intuition behind our research design in this light. So just to convince you that the death of a close relative is actually an important trigger both for mental health problems and for benzodiazepine prescription, you can see that at the time, so there are the years away from the death of a close relative. So the death of a close relative happens between -1 and 0 here. And you see that at the time of the death, there is a large spike in the diagnosis for mental health problems. You see, they pass from roughly 20% to above 40%. This higher mean is due to the fact that we have a subsample of people that already might have had in the past or in the future a mental health problem. In the full data set, there is still a spike, but they start from a lower percentage. Also, you observe that at the time of the death of a close relative, there is a huge spike also in benzodiazepine prescription. Probably the death of a relative is already increasing before, a few years before, both prescription and diagnosis, but the spike at year zero is clear, is sharp, okay? And what else? I think this figure should convince you that the death of a relative is a clear trigger of both the mental health problem and benzodiazepine prescriptions. It's also important to stress that given our research design, the fact that we focus on a washout period of 3 years, we take only patients, this is the full sample, we only take patients in which the pre-period mean is always zero for both benzodiazepine and mental health problems. So this is just motivational. So now we have two working samples. So one working sample is the working sample we use to estimate the propensity. We consider the universe of Nivel patients in the Netherlands over the period 2009 and 2020. So roughly 10 million observation of people that are enrolled in this practice of Nivel. And then there is the second sample that is the natural experiment sample, where we only focus on patients that experience this loss of a relative over the period 2010 and 2019 with no previous benzodiazepine treatment, insomnia, anxiety, or depression diagnosis. Our focus is on people 18 to 65 for labor market outcome, 18 to 75 for health outcome. So at the end, we have around more than 100,000 patients. When we focus on the entire sample, including also the new guys, the new patient that we received only a few weeks ago, we reach almost 200,000 people. Are there questions? Okay. So now we go to the first step. The first step is pretty common in this quasi-random assignment literature. So basically, on the whole sample of Nivelle patient, we estimate our prescribing propensity measure using a leave one out residualized approach, a sort of jackknife. In other words, we estimate the probability of receiving a prescription by the individual I in practice J at time T, and we only include a set of fixed effect for time. The W is the neighborhood fixed effect diagnosis. And we also add, only for reason of precision, some socioeconomic characteristics, but I will show you that doesn't change much, it just reduce the noise. Then we take the residual and we aggregate this residual, excluding the patient I from the residual. So we have individual propensities, because each individual is not included in his own propensity. And then, in order to improve the interpretation of the result, we rescale this propensity by the difference between the 90 and the 10 percentile. So in other words, you can interpret we can interpret our coefficient as moving from the 10th to the 90th percentile of our propensity to prescribe. So from low prescribers to very high prescribers. So this is, again, for exogeneity reason, we only need to condition on neighborhood fixed effect. We also add the diagnosis and socioeconomic characteristic only to improve precision.
Fabrizio, can I ask a question? So do you have any sense of how much variation there is within a practice?
I will show you, yeah.
Okay.
Within a practice, you mean?
Right.
I can tell you across practices.
Right, yeah.
I don't know within practices. Over time, not much. This is what I can tell you. So we use, since we take the residual and we sum up also over T, means that this is a time invariant propensity, okay? And we check whether this is a reasonable assumption. And I mean, even if we use a time varying propensity, the result so is a straight line, no? Is the correlation is pretty high. So we prefer to focus on a time invariant to reduce the noise. So of course, this is the trade-off we faced.
Yes. Now I'm just wondering, like, if there is a practice with many GPs, then...
Yes, sure. This is true, but this is possible. Yeah, yeah. And but this is an information that we don't have.
Okay.
We ask a lot to know how many GPs there are in a practice, and we were not allowed to have this information.
Okay, I see.
Yeah, yeah. And this is important. Not maybe with this paper is not fundamental, but for future research it is. Because if you want to understand what is driving this with different propensity, you need to have to know also what are the characteristics of the doctors. But they said no information on doctor whatsoever.
Okay, clear.
That's it. So this is the variation we have in our propensity. So it's distributed. I mean, there is variation that we can exploit. And this is a sort of regressions on the benzo propensity, on the residualized rate on the benzo propensity. So this is telling you that as you move, for example, if you move from 0 to 1, you have an increase of roughly 3.5 percentage point in the propensity, in the prescription rate. And it's also interesting, sorry, I went one slide. It's also interesting that it's pretty linear. So it's not due to really bad doctors that are here. So the linear approximation seems to be pretty good, right? You see. So if you move from -1 to 0, in terms of increase in the estimated propensity in the actual prescription rate is the same as moving from 0 to 1. So in other words, it's linear, and there are non-linear, and it's not due to non-linear effect, okay, to a cluster of very bad doctor driving all the variation. This is the message of this figure. And even most important is to show that that our measure is not, so that the patient pools of doctors are pretty similar, no, across practices. And this is a sort of balancing test called, let me call it so, although this is not a balancing test, I'm regressing our propensity to prescribe on an incredibly large set of variables, socio-demographics, economic variables, healthcare expenditure, type of debt, diagnosis. These are drugs that suggest that these people have or not some kind of cardiovascular diseases. So a really long list of variables that point out towards socio-demographic, economic characteristics, and the health characteristics, and even conditionally. So only a few coefficients are statistically significant, like age and urbanization, that suggest that practice where doctors prescribe more antidepressants tend to have slightly older patients and are more likely to be in cities, okay? But if you look at the coefficient has been all standardized. So this is 0.2 of a standard deviation, and this is 0.4. So when you look at the balancing table of randomized experiment, this would be already a good success, you know, in terms of balancing. But still, there are some differences, and these differences basically disappear when we condition on neighborhood fixed effect. So all these differences in urbanization age are no longer statistically significant. The F test on the whether we get reject or not, that all coefficients are equal to zero, drop from 4 to 2.5. And when we add also socioeconomic characteristics and diagnosis, basically nothing changed. There is a slight decrease in the F-test from 2.5 to 2.4. Just to tell you that conditioning on diagnosis and sociodemographic doesn't matter, is only important for precision. And even unconditional, this patient pools are pretty similar. Once you condition for neighborhood fixed effect, basically the patient pools are arguably similar across across practices. Questions on this? Okay. So that was the first step. Then there is a second step regarding the definitive part. So it's not exactly a standard definitive. Why? Because, of course, we have individual and time-fixed effect, age bins, but different from a standard definitive, we are not interested in the event time coefficient that goes from -3 years before the death of a relative to up to 6 years afterwards. But what matters for us is the interaction term. So the interaction term between event study coefficient and the propensity to prescribe. In other words, we want to see the heterogeneity in the effect of the death of a relative based on the doctor you face, okay? So the idea is that these people might all suffer from a death after the death of a relative. They all have an increase in benzodiazepine prescription, but those that are enrolled in more lenient practice might eventually show a large increase in benzodiazepine and also have different healthcare and employment outcomes. So in other words, the coefficient of interest for us and what I'm going to show you in our figures is gamma k and not delta k. So delta k is the coefficient on the event time, while gamma k is the coefficient on the interaction term between the event time and the propensity to prescribe. So to conclude, I want to be a bit more formal regarding the identification assumption, not too formal, I want to list them more specifically. So first of all, since this is a definitive, you need parallel trends. But different from a standard definitive, it's important to stress that the fact that pretrends are parallel does not guarantee, but this is in general, eh? The fact that you have pretrends that are parallel does guarantee that trends are parallel also afterwards. That is the core of the fact that you cannot test parallel trends. In this specific case, it's important because if these patients are somewhat different, so for instance, if the patient enrolled in modeling and practice are, let's say, of worse health, then it is possible that they react differently to a shock. So it's important then for us that the patient pool across doctors is the same, because otherwise, having parallel pretrends does not guarantee that afterwards these trends are going to be the same after the shock. So they might react to the shock in a different way because people enrolled in different practice might be different. This is important. And of course, this is an untestable assumption. I shown you before all these F-tests that seems quite convincing. In order to convince you, we do also something more. We try to relax our assumption on conditional exogeneity. And I think I should have time, I will show you what I have in mind. But we try to use a weaker assumption. Then the other assumption is no anticipation, and death of a relative might be eventually anticipated in some case of death, like, for instance, cancer death. This should appear somewhere in pretrends, but in any case, as a robustness check, we exclude cancer deaths. Last but not least, there is all the discussion about homogeneous treatment effect that is recent in the econ literature. Unfortunately, we know how to address the problem with gamma K, but there are no estimator to address this homogeneous treatment effect problem for the interaction term. What we did, we used the insight of Salmon and Abrams. So we basically estimate the effect for each treatment cohort. So for each so we had different cohort from that might happen between 2010 and 2019. So we estimate the effect for each treatment cohort, and then we average out the effect bootstrapping the standard errors. This is the only way to construct an estimator that is close to Salmon and Abrams without using the Salmon and Abrams estimator. Of course, if you know a way to do it in a different way, please let me know. I will be really happy to figure out. Questions before I move to the results?
There is one in the chat, I think.
Oh, okay.
Stefanson, you want to raise the question yourself?
Yeah, sure. Hey, so I'm just curious about like the possibility that the doctors who prescribe benzodiazepines are either more or less likely to do something simultaneously with these patients at the treatment time.
So other treatment, you mean?
Yeah, exactly. For example,
exactly. Like... No, sure. This is something we will. I never talk about IV. I will always talk in terms of reduced form approach, meaning that we cannot exclude that it's due to other things they do. But I will show you something later to try to figure out whether this is due to benzodiazepine treatment or other kind of treatment. But for sure, you're right. Now, so the results should be faster. So here, this is the effect, so the interaction term effect on benzodiazepine take up after the death of a relative. So pretrends are by construction zero, the differences, because these are patients with a washing out period of 3 years. So you see that patient enrolled in more lenient practice or moving from the 10 to the 90 percentile increase the probability of a patient receiving benzodiazepine by 3% of 3 percentage point more. That is roughly 40% of the jump we have seen here. So 40% of this jump is basically this 3% estimated here. It decreases a bit after 2-3 years, but remain quite stable. So to recap, this is the effect on interaction term. So after the death of the relative, these people enrolled in more lenient practice are more likely to receive benzodiazepine. And this difference is 3.5 percentage point that correspond to 40% of the jump in the other figure. And these people also observe somewhat an increase in healthcare cost. The figure is a bit compressed because I wanted to show you also the cumulative effect. Effect are statistically significant at 5 or 10% in almost all years. And these effects are not small. They correspond to more or less 10% of the pre-period mean, roughly 200 euros. They sum up over time to above 1,000 euros. We try to sum up the result in a table, dividing the effect in short, medium, and long run effect. And I mean, the result are confirmed that we have seen in the event study figure. So 3% at the beginning and then goes down to 2.5 for benzodiazepine prescription. A large share of this prescription are due to what we call potentially inappropriate prescription. They don't only prescribe more benzodiazepine, but many of these prescriptions seems to be also not appropriate. And we also observe an increase in healthcare expenditure of about 150 at the beginning and more than 200 euros after 4 years. And this corresponds to more than 10% of the pre-period mean expenditure of these people. We don't find, however, large differences in mental health care expenditure. This is the result for health. So I can tell you that this increase, I have other figures that I won't show you today for reason of time. Such increase in healthcare expenditure seems to be driven by hospital expenditure, but not hospital expenditure due to inpatient care, but outpatient care. So they spend more on specialists. So in the Dutch setting, specialists work mainly in hospital setting and they don't have their own practice. Now, and also to conclude the most important part of the result, we also check what happens to income. So at the beginning, we don't see large differences in income, but then these people after 3-4 years start to have also a drop in income compared to the other people enrolled in less lenient practice, up to 1,000 euro per year. And this is partly due to a gradual decrease in employment probabilities. They start to be significant only after five years. And we also know that these people have an increased probability of receiving social assistance, benefits, any kind of welfare benefit. In this case, probably unemployment benefits, but also, not immediately after 4 or 5 years, disability benefits. This is what we find. Again, in a table, different from healthcare result, employment and eventually social assistance uptake of welfare benefit appear only in the medium and long term. For instance, employment effects start to show up only in the medium term and become largely significant and also large in terms of percentage, because this is almost 1 percentage point only after 4 years. Social assistance, probably this is uptake in unemployment benefits that starts to show up already after 2-3 years. And this, I mean, mirror the increase in unemployment. And then at the end, we also see effect on disability. And this total effect of social assistance put together probably unemployment benefits and disability benefits. In terms of income, the average effect estimated is around 800 euros. Per year. And here again, in total, you see after 6 years is more than 2,500 euros. We also have some other results, but I think it's important to conclude on time to go straight to previous question. As this reduced form effect due to difference in benzodiazepine prescription rate across GP, or maybe they might be due to other characteristics that are correlated with this leniency, not with this propensity to prescribe benzodiazepine. Of course, the perfect test that does not exist, but we can check whether there are increase in other drugs like antidepressants or opioids. And because if you see a similar increase in this drug, maybe it's not due to benzodiazepine, but it's due to antidepressants or opioids. But what we found is actually that these drugs increase only after 4 or 5 years. So it seems to follow more than cause the effect we have seen before. So, and what we do also is to construct leniency for antidepressant, we don't find similar results. The other thing we do is to take another measure of low value care, that is the propensity to prescribe antibiotics. Clearly, antibiotics are not low value care, but prescribing too many antibiotics is usually considered low value care because you are prescribing to people also after one day of flu. Okay. So usually doctors that prescribe too many antibiotics are doctors that have poor outcomes. And what we do, we construct an alternative leniency based on antibiotics to see whether also this leniency is able to reproduce the same result, but actually we don't find anything similar. Of course, there is a correlation with benzodiazepine uptake, but less than 1%, but we found nothing on income and healthcare expenditure when we use this alternative leniency. So I hope this partially, of course, it cannot fully solve the cannot tell us whether these reduced form effects are due to benzodiazepine or other for other kind of treatment. For instance, we don't know whether these people are doing less therapy. This is another important thing we cannot check with the data at the moment. So last but not least, I told you that we also try to relax the quasi-random assignment assumption that is implicit in our identification strategy. Actually, it's a conditional quasi-random assignment, conditional neighborhood fixed effect. What we do, we construct an alternative leniency measure that only exploit the GP response after the death of a close relative. So in other words, what we do, we allow the patient to know and eventually select on GP propensity to prescribe benzodiazepine, but we assume, and this is the only assumption we make, that they cannot predict the change in prescribing behavior after the death of a relative. So in practice, in an equation, meaning that we estimate the probability of being prescribed a benzodiazepine by Dr. J, and we add the doctor fixed effect and the interaction between the doctor fixed effect and the post period. And so instead of taking the residual as before, we take this coefficient gamma 2, that is the change in the doctor in the doctor prescribing behavior after the death of a relative. Okay. So in other words, we allow the patient to select on doctor fixed effect, but we assume that they cannot predict the change in their behavior when a relative dies. This is our alternative assumption, and the results are pretty similar. So there is not much to stress here. If ever, they are even slightly larger. So maybe if you want to have some question, I try to close soon. If you are interested, we also look at heterogeneity by sex and age. We don't find large difference, only the fact that the healthcare results are mostly driven by the older subsample, and there is no clear heterogeneity by gender. The Sarin-Abrams estimates are similar, and we try to balance cohort to have balancing in event time. We exclude cancer death. We exclude one type of relative death at time because we cannot exclude them. So we cannot focus on a single type of death because we don't have power. That's more or less all. Regarding my conclusion, I mean, we find a doctor prescribing style seems to influence individual health and labor market trajectory after a common mental health shock. And this doctor are more likely to prescribe benzodiazepine to their patient often for too long, out of current guidelines, but we cannot, of course, exclude that some of these effects are driven by other characteristics of these doctors. Future research will devote to, first of all, confirm the results in a larger sample, because for so far, what I've shown you to you is based on a 50% sample. And we would like to better pin down the mechanism behind the health and labor market effect. And if NIVEL will ever give us better data, we would like to explain the determinants of this variation in prescribing behavior and eventually its correlation with diagnosis skills of doctors. I think that's all. In the meantime, it's pretty dark here. I have only a small light here. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Fabrizio. It doesn't look like we have additional questions. So if anyone wants to ask something, otherwise I will have a final question for Fabrizio.
I have a question.
Go ahead, Anna.
Very interesting presentation, Fabrizio, and really impressive results. Have you tried to look at the characteristics of the GPs that are associated with lenient prescription?
Sorry. I didn't hear you.
Have you tried to look at the characteristics of the GPs that make them more likely to prescribe benzodiazepines?
No, because we don't have doctor characteristics. Unless you look at geographical characteristics, that's something that we can do. I wanted to do a map, but Peter told me that I can't. So Peter Bucks, my co-author, it's very strict. He said, you can do maps with the doctor leniency because otherwise they can be identified just to say whether there is variation over space. But more than that, I can't. That's unfortunately because it's already something that we receive the data.
Thank you.
And Stevenson,
but for sure,
also...
it's super interesting would be to know. So for instance, whether they also change the prescribing behavior, whether the sex of the socioeconomic status of the patient is different based on their own sex. These are all cool questions that I cannot address with the data I have now. Sorry.
No, it's fine. So Stevenson also has a couple of questions. Stevenson, do you want to raise them directly?
Just to like spitball again, really cool presentation. Awesome. Like, very cool result. I was just wondering, kind of spitballing off of this idea of like the doctors being part of the problem here. We just can't observe them, right? Is there any way to like use a mover strategy here? Are there a lot of patients skipping around practices at all? Or is that
no,
fairly
because
infrequently
it's a subset.
Done?
Sorry, please continue.
Oh, no, I'm finished.
Sorry. No. Hey, no, we cannot use a mover strategy because we have a subset of the GP practices. So if you move in another practice, we observe the mover strategy can be done. But if you are not, and you there are 90% probability that you are not, this is impossible. Yeah. We talked at the beginning. So we have the data we have.
All right. So if you don't have further questions, all right. Yeah, please go.
I was just wondering, just to understand, Fabrizio, when you said sort of the parallel trends assumption, so I'm trying to sort of understand fully what is the exact control group here. So these are people without the death of a relative, I guess?
No, they are not in the sample.
Okay. So these are only people who
experience the same death. At most, right. A different timing.
Right.
But honestly, also this... I would like to talk with you about this because in theory, the point is the interaction term.
Uh-huh.
So it's not even because the parallel trend would be people that had the death at a different point in time. This would be in a standard diff. In this case, we are looking at the interaction term. So the control group are people with a different degree, no? Different leniency in the distribution.
Right.
So it's not straightforward also to me. I talk with a lot of people. I talk also with Goodman Begon. It's not straightforward to figure out what is the best strategy. So I try to stay on the safe side to say parallel trend is not sufficient. I want to have also some form of random assignment, no? Or quasi-random assignment.
Right. Yeah. I wonder whether you can make it even more explicit, sort of studying literally people who have had the same shock but then a few years later or so, right? So make them explicit as a control group. Now it all seems a bit, I don't know.
I mean, they are there, okay, and this is what you do when you do a diff, and also the San and Abrams in some sense also use this variation, no? But yeah. I think that is going to affect more the event time coefficient than the interaction.
The interaction, yeah, possibly. Yeah.
This is my impression. Because many people at the beginning were thinking, In my case, this is not an intensity of the shock. Because other, so you have this, if you have this variation, no? In which instead of having 0-1, you have intensity of the treatment. Mm-hmm. Many papers are like this, no? This is a bit different. This is different because it's not the intensity of the treatment. I'm not saying that the shock is larger for somebody than another. So I'm saying that the shock is the same, but the how you react to the shock changed based on the doctor. So the interaction term, not the... Because of course, if I want to obtain larger effect, I put the interaction term, I remove the interaction term, I base the event study on the directly on the propensity to prescribe. But I don't think it's correct.
Yeah.
All right, so there are a couple of additional questions in the chat, but in the interest of time, I would stop the seminar here. And then eventually we can stay a few more minutes for those who want to stay for asking you directly the questions. So I would like to thank Fabrizio for this very, very interesting presentation and for the results. And also to present the next presenter, which is going to be Holger Strulik in a month time, who is going to present a paper on COVID-19 and the economics of aging and longevity. I would like to thank all participants. And for those who want to stay a couple of more minutes to ask questions to Fabrizio, you're welcome to do so. So thank you very much again.
Thank you.